Borough Council meeting of February 13, 2017. Will now come to order, please rise for the pledge of allegiance led by Mayor Sims.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Ritchie.
Here.
Mr. Bennett. Mr. Butler.
Here.
Mr. Chesno.
Here.
Ms. Dixon.
Here.
Mr. Ellis.
Here.
Mrs. Wilford.
Here.
Mayor Sims.
Here.
Mr. Gore.
Here.
Here we go.
Okay, is there any citizen comment tonight, please?
Yeah, just.
Rise, give your name and address.
My name is Dan Reagan, 69 Shalai Avenue. I'd just like to address, our bike curb appeal in our borough. I know that there's an issue about ordinances being enforced and taken to, to its fullest extent to maybe get some of these things corrected. I talked to a couple of borough people, so I'm kind of aware of the situation that you guys are having. And I'm glad you have the problem and not I. But, I walk my dog, and I really didn't realize it because I'm a night dweller. I work all night, I sleep all day. So you don't see a lot, but when I'm walking my dog, I'm starting to pay attention to things that are going on. And one of the major ones that's really disgusted me is the way the borough is letting people just throw their garbage out their front doors next to the porches, and they're not even using cans in some cases. I just spent last fall building a garbage can containment area in the back of my house because that's the way I've always done it. I had the privilege of buy a house across the street from Mrs. Dixon's parents, and they were very quick to address my issues as I came into this neighborhood. What I'm getting at is some of these ordinances, the people that are moving in don't know. I've asked some of these people that have moved in, I've become friends with them. I said, do you realize that your garbage can should be at least beside your house, if not behind your house? Now, I may have overstepped my boundaries there because I don't exactly know what the ordinance is. I just know what I was taught.
You're right.
Okay? But I can count seven houses within spitting distance of my front porch that they literally walk out the front door and throw it over the railing. And, it's not like I'm asking anybody to paint their house. I'm not asking them to repair their sidewalks, which I could get into that, but because I have that also right across from me, but appeal it's real easy.
No.
This is real easy.
All right, well,
I like to volunteer. Like I said, I walk my dog. I would be more than glad to, if we were to put some ordinances together that were blatantly being abused, I'd be more than glad to stuff them in mailboxes.
That's a possibility, and for some people that already moved in, and there's been a discussion about putting some things together, like a welcome packet for new people. But let me just address the original issue you brought up about curb appeal and things like that. We actually had a very lengthy meeting the other night with Crafton officials about code enforcement and the fact that we need to be more proactive with code enforcement than just in general, we hear and there everywhere that you're responding to complaints and you're not really trying to get out in front of things. And we had this long meeting the other day. We have another follow-up meeting with them. We discussed about maybe a joint code enforcement officer, which may or may not happen. But we also discussed coordinating our ordinances with the new magistrate coming in. And that we need to be more aggressive and not less aggressive. But then there's the other side of the story, too. I mean, we did some very minor things a few years ago. Like, we tried to get people to put their house numbers in. And you wouldn't believe the blowback from that. It's the people yelling and screaming and complaining, and they got citations. No one got a citation. But, I mean, that's not always a simple thing to do, to just let people know and then they stop. It's not that simple. But I think it's a good point that maybe that's something that we can do. Maybe almost like a frequently asked question thing that we can say that they're, these are the kind of ordinances like that. That's a good example. You can't put your garbage out before a certain time and things like that. And maybe that's something we need
to do. Or at least in containers. I mean, I know two.
That's part of the ordinance.
They're not even in containers. They're throwing white hefty bags right out. I mean, they're not even putting them in garbage cans.
Yeah, you would think that would be sort of a common sense thing, but apparently it's not. But
I know firsthand we got skunks in the neighborhood, and I'm sure everybody else knows. Right. Skunks love garbage.
Right. So anyway, I think that's a good point, and I think that's something we should definitely look at as far as getting something out. Because you're right, a lot of people just don't know what some of the ordinances are for cutting your grass or shoveling your sidewalk or putting your garbage on. And that one, I don't think it would be a big production.
I'm glad you guys had a meeting about it, because I was, like I said, kind of aware of what was going on in the past. And I don't know if I understand right, but our ordinance guy has resigned.
Right.
So, you know.
Well, we have. I mean, we're doing ordinances. Our road crew foreman is authorized by us to handle complaints and code enforcement issues. So it's not, we don't have a lapse in coverage.
Okay. So something's going to go on. We're working on it.
Yeah, and like I said, we had that lengthy meeting. We're going to follow up sometime this month with Crafton over at Crafton to try to be more proactive with these things. Because that property maintenance is something that's sort of low-hanging fruit that you can do to raise property values.
Yeah, well, but, I mean, I have a nice house.
Keep that in mind, though. Most people don't really want to hear it, but at least they're aware of that.
Well, they're aware of something, but it's not like it's costing them any money. I guess maybe buy a garbage can.
Right, right.
But I mean, I got a couple extra garbage.
That's a good point, though. And that's something I think we can bring up when we meet with them about some kind of handout. So people do know. Maybe
like I said, once again, I volunteer my time.
I'll keep that in mind.
You know what I mean?
Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
That ordinance.
Mr. O'Hara. And address?
A.D. Sampson.
Thank you.
That ordinance reads that it should be out of sight from the street.
Right.
Not beside your house, behind a fence or behind a house. Mm-hmm. So nobody can see it.
Right.
And they're all over the place.
Right.
I mean, I've seen gas cans sitting in driveways right out in front of our eyes. You know?
You're right.
It's a shame. It's a nice word because I got a letter for leaving them out.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and that's what we're trying to get on track to take care of some of those issues. Because I think, you know, when you're just reacting to complaints, then you're not really addressing the problem. You're addressing the problem one at a time. But, I mean, we tried that with broken sidewalks and got excoriated for that. And we tried it with the street numbers and that didn't play real well either. But I mean, those kind of things, you're going to make a lot of enemies and people aren't going to be happy with people that have to do it. But you're right, that's what the ordinance reads, and that's something that we can try to address with this graphic thing. If we can get somebody that adds some hours and be more proactive instead of just reacting to complaints, that's what we're going to try to do. Anyone else?
Lena Twigg, 97 Linshaw. I know there's been some complaints on websites and whatnot about the speeding on Ingram Avenue. It is out of control. I know two kids last week that almost got hit trying to cross the street over the bus stops. I know we have a speed limit sign down there, but it's crazy. My son almost got hit twice now just crossing on the crosswalk in between coming down from the busway, crossing Foster. He almost got hit. And then he actually got clipped in between, in the crosswalk on the side of the shopping center at Sampson. The lady coming out of the shopping center went to turn right, and she couldn't because the cars were coming up Ingram Avenue, so he started to cross the sidewalk, or across the crosswalk, and she came up and clipped him, got his shoe off and everything. And it's just crazy. They're speeding through the shopping center and then also up on Ingram Avenue. It's just...
Well, the shopping center is one issue. Streets are another issue. There's data on those, retrievable data on those speed limits, those speed things. So Sharon, maybe you can follow up with Jack about retrieving that data, see what it is, and maybe we can see about increasing some enforcement down there. Okay.
Yeah, I mean it's always done that way. I mean we always had more, and I'm not picking on anybody, but it's always been known that the police sat down there and people slowed, never known where, and they slowed down. Mm-hmm. Well, we don't seem to be having that down there anymore, so people...
I'm sure that's doable. So Sharon, you'll follow up with Jack on that?
We're sitting down right now, though.
Oh, yeah, I've seen him in Dunn's. Yeah, I've seen him.
Mr. Damp?
Dave Damp, 7 July. And just to add to that, that speed sign that kind of like alternates between like Shalai, and then I think you have it like it goes down to Linshaw or someplace.
Yeah.
Well, over the weekend, just to add to what Malina was saying, I saw a car 42 mile an hour going up Ingram Avenue. Before I could even like get its license plate, it was gone. So like, and now you said it's retrievable data. Is there like a cam or anything that is able to like get a picture?
No.
I don't know if you noticed that if you go over a certain mile an hour, that thing starts flashing.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, it hit the
that's supposed to.
Because I was coming out of Sampson and I saw this car come way up Ingram Avenue. I'm like, I'm not pulling.
That's supposed to bring it to your attention.
And he went up. He didn't slow down.
Run buses, red lights.
Yeah, I mean it's everywhere. I mean that's not just an Ingram thing, but we'll get into that Ingram Avenue thing. This is Dan.
Barb Dan, 53 Sampson. I do stand on the corner of Shalai most afternoons, putting my grandkids, taking them off the bus. I will say that the police have been behind the bus and catching them going through it. However, the 5 to 10 minutes before, we actually have to keep the kids in the morning back on Shalai. Those cars tear around there so fast up and down. And when I see kids on a corner, I like break it because you never know when they're going to run out. But I do. The police are behind the buses most of the time, at least 2 days a week. But it's before the bus actually comes.
Well, we can look into that. See if we can get it.
I hate to beat this horse, but on my way home, I come down Prospect off the cobblestones, and I always go very slow. And I have had twice cars on my tail end, literally pass me. Literally pass me. And I have seen the officers sitting in the busway.
Yep.
They sit in the busway, but you know, once we hit that flat, man, they take off. I've had cars pass me. I know it's an issue.
Don't construe this the wrong way, but unfortunately, that's sort of like a societal thing now. But everyone's in a U-turn. Anywhere you go, I'm sure you guys are around other towns, and people are in a hurry. They're not stopping at stop signs. They're blowing through yield signs. They don't stop at crosswalks. People are just in a general hurry. It's a problem. And, we'll do the best we can.
I'm Helen Hamilton, 97 Lynchville Avenue. I know they had a problem with this on Wingap. And they did a four-way stop at Wind Gap and Chartiers. That fixed the problem.
Well, there used to be a light.
There used to be a light, but they had more crashes with the light than they did with the stop signs.
Yeah.
If you do a four-way stop, shopping center has a stop sign there. Sampson has a stop sign. Just put two stop signs, one at Sampson on Ingram Avenue and one on the corner there. On Ingram Avenue. That's a four-way stop. That way it stops people saying, oh wow, I don't have to stop till I get to the red light at the bridge. It stops it.
Yeah, well, and then people come out of they bump through the stop sign and then rev it coming out of the stop sign. There's some laws too about as far as using stop signs for traffic control. And it's not quite that easy. I know.
It would solve the problem.
You put a stop sign at every intersection for everything, and that would probably solve a lot of problems. I don't know how legal that would really be.
Maybe we can check with Roslyn Forms, because I know Roslyn Forms has that one, they were having a problem years ago going down, I guess it's King's Highway, onto the parkway. And I can tell you right now, I don't
find them.
Because
they
know, you know that the cops are on that road.
Well, that's the key. It's the enforcement side. It's not
necessarily the and you know that they're in the driveways. You don't know which driveway they're in.
Which is what we had before.
And so, maybe we can look at something like on how they did that.
Well, it's just a matter of getting them on the road and not being a priority. I don't even think they have their own place up there anymore.
I
know.
They always read a
police
officer.
Always.
Contract stopped it.
Okay, anyone else?
No.
I'd like to add something.
Sure, go
ahead. Part of the comprehensive plan, it's finalized, but it's not officially finalized as far as voting and so forth. It does have a a large segment in there about making the crosswalks, especially the major ones, more visible with possible flashing lights, definitely brighter colors, different textures. Just there's a lot of different ideas in different communities. Folks that are doing unique ways to just highlight a crosswalk and at least increase the awareness. You know, enforcing the speeding is a tough thing to do with a small police force, and it is societal. But if you make the crosswalk more visible, then I think folks will. It's a start.
It's a start.
I mean, downtown Pittsburgh has crosswalks that are like,
Yeah, they're like breaking.
You can see it from a mile away.
And then that sign says 4, 3, 2, 1.
But I mean, I'm looking on that. But have we looked at anything else as far as like the lighting down Ingram Avenue? That's where I'm talking about the crosswalks. Like going to the LEDs?
But there's only so many you can get at a time, and we're sort of looking at that and seeing about prioritizing that, looking for mostly locations where it's really bad, you can't see it all. And so we're sort of in that process right now.
Yeah, that came up in the both communities in the comprehensive plan as far as walkability and visibility, safety. It's in the plan. It was one of the top four concerns. So you're not alone. It's a problem.
Yeah. Well, when my son was done, that was my big thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll have the police look into that. We'll try to retrieve some of that data and see if we can improve some enforcement. Okay, thank you. Where are we at? Engineers report, Brian Paul.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have the email here from Alcasan about the sanitary sewer manhole at Prospect and Ingram Avenue. We will add that to our takeoff contract for the summer. Just a quick update on the flow target. I believe that Three Rivers will be sending out an update letter on the flow target, and Gateway will also be following up with a letter, and Rick plans on meeting with the HHS committee at February meeting to review the details for that.
Okay. All right. Any questions for the engineer? Thank you, Brian. Committee reports, Highway Health and Sanitation, Mr. Butler.
Thank you, Mr. President. I did have a committee meeting on January 31st. Is that correct? Yeah, 31st. Brian was there, and an associate has updated us on our MS4 compliance, which is part of the Clean Water Act, Federal Clean Water Act consent decree that we've been staying ahead of for the last, I think, 15 years. So we're doing fine, everything's in order. He just was there to update us on things that are coming up, some reporting that Gateway Engineers is gonna be doing. So it was a really good update for us, for the committee. We also talked about some of the Shaycog, lining and so forth that we talk about each meeting. And then lastly, we discussed the 2017 road program. And there's a motion tonight for that. We narrowed it down, as I've stated last month, to it was about 15 streets. We narrowed that down even further to 9. Brian brought an estimated cost for the different types of reconstruction or repaving, depending on the road surface and the condition of it. And he provided that estimate at our last meeting. From there, the committee went out and looked at the roads, and so the Gateway. We came up with a short list of three roads that we can afford to pave. It's not absolutely finalized, but it's probably going to be Berry Street. That would be between Center and West Prospect. It would be Foster Avenue between the, I don't know where it ends at the shopping center, but between West Ingram Avenue and wherever it ends, Crafton border.
Right this also.
Yep, and we've decided on that because Crafton's also paving their half of it, so there's huge cost savings in us doing it. It's not quite as bad as some streets, but it's getting there, so I think it's worth doing because we will save a substantial amount of money. And lastly would be Danvers, the entire front. I guess it goes.
I can't hear when there's a lot of conversation.
The entire stretch of Danvers. from Oxbow to, what's that street called?
Hudson.
Hudson. So that's most likely, the one that's another possibility, not in addition to, but the replacement of this street would be Wheeler. But that's a little more complicated because it's concrete and the curbs, it's what's called monolithic pour, right? So the curbs and the street are all concrete and they're all poured as one unit. So redoing the street and maintaining curbs is a bit of a challenge. Plus, we don't really know the ultimate cost of Foster because of handicap ramps. There'll be quite a few because there's quite a few entrances onto that road. So that's it on the, I'm gonna make a motion after my report to prepare those bid specs. And then as far as the brick programs, we had a separate meeting that Mr. Nucci was at and a couple of us from the committee. We talked with a woman from an organization that recruits high school students for summer work to work to do community work, and she's overwhelmed with respondents, I guess, participants. The program's taken off. It started last year. It's a well-funded program. It's a county program. And she was able to employ all of her high school students last year, and it all gained momentum, so she has about twice as many high school students this year. So they would provide, if all went well, the labor and pay for the labor. They would also pay for the workman's comp, and we would have to provide a supervisor. So we have another meeting scheduled in a couple of weeks to follow up on that, so that's very good news.
And the focus on that is, and the focus on that was hopefully we can get a couple of crews working on brick streets.
Right, she said we could potentially have up to eight workers working with one supervisor. So
that would be the focus of that program. That would be in addition to our normal summer help, that would be the sole focus of those.
So with that kind of volume, there would be production, and then it would be huge cost savings. So that was a very encouraging meeting. So that's all I have for my report. With that said, I'll make my motion if I can find it. A motion to authorize the borough engineer to prepare bid specifications for the 2017 road program.
Second. Motion has been made and seconded by Mr. Ellis. Any questions on the roll call, please?
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesna?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs.
Wilford? Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And that program, from the evidence that we have seen and from other communities, worked very well last year, so we're hopeful that we can work that out. Okay, any questions for Highway Health and Sanitation? Thank you, Greg. Parks and Recreation, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. President. I don't have very much going on right now. I do have a Ingram Days meeting coming up soon. They're trying to get it scheduled with everything else going on. I'll let everyone know when that actually is going to take place. I just don't know when it's going to take place. I do have to call Allegheny County again because they didn't send me the correct number of signs, so I'll get a hold of them. She got a new helper, so I ended up telling the intern screwed it up.
So no smoking sign?
Yeah, they didn't give me two. They were supposed to give me 17, so I got to get a hold of them, and I'll get an email out hopefully tomorrow.
If it would be helpful, if you could get
them. Great. Well, I told her I'd come get them. So she decided she wanted to drop them off, and then she dropped off two signs, so I don't know why. But I'll get a hold of her, and we'll get it straightened out. And if not, and then we might have to write a couple signs. So I'll double check that the application was turned in right.
Okay.
So I have
questions for Parks and Recreation. Thank you, Joe. Police and Fireman's Dixon.
My report tonight is we had asked the police chief to give us a list of intersections that we could change our streetlights to LEDs. He hasn't submitted that. So Sharon, if you can just follow up with Josh on that. Allison, have a few motions tonight. A motion to authorize an expenditure not to exceed $1,000 to Staley Communications to remove the equipment from the fire engine number 3.
Second. Motions were made and seconded by Mr. Chesna. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesna?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
A motion to authorize an expenditure not to exceed $1,000 to Baker Roofing to repair the roof at former Runnymede Fire Station.
Second. Motion's made and seconded by Mr. Chesno. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Major?
Yes.
A motion to ratify the phone vote of 2617, authorizing the police lieutenant training seminar at the police academy on April 27, 2017, at the cost of $285.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded by Mr. Chesno. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes. Anything else, Chief?
That's all right.
Any questions for police and fire? Karen, finance, Mrs. Wilford.
Thank you. Helena, is your son okay?
Yeah. He just had a little bit of a bruise on his ankle, but he's good. Thank you.
Just as far as reports go, and to speak with Mr. Chesno more in depth on this later, we're in the very early stages of the Easter egg hunt and prepping for that, which will be set up right now for April 15th. And then I just have my general finance motions to make. The first is a motion to pay the expenses for the month of February 2017 as follows. The general fund, $17,181.95. The recreation fund, $304.61. The sewer fund, $6,652.89. And the liquid fuels fund, $8,076.88.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded by Mr. Ellis. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
A motion to ratify the payment of the January 19, 2017 payroll in the amount of $23,136.63 and the February 2nd, 2017 payroll in the amount of $22,906.08.
Second. Motion is made and seconded on Mr. Ellis. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
A motion to ratify the payment of expenses on January 30th, 2017 as follows. The general fund, $11,420.29, and the payroll fund, $1,878.17.
Second. Motion is made and seconded by Mr. Ellis. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
A motion to ratify the payment of expenses on January 31st, 2017 as follows. The general fund, $7,495.70. The recreation fund, $23.87. And the sewer fund, $3,273.39.
Second. Motion made and seconded by Mr. Ellis. Any questions? Call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
And a motion to ratify the payment expenses on February 8th, 2017 as follows. The general fund, $321.43, and payroll fund, $2,364.47.
Second by Mr. Ellis. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
And Mr. Major?
Yes.
All I have for
any questions for finance? Dr. Samantha? Building and zoning, obviously Mr. Bennett isn't here, but just to reiterate, that was a very productive meeting with Kraft, and a lot of good ideas came up that we need to follow up on. There's a lot of action items to follow up on, and I think it's going to be a productive thing, dealing with property maintenance and code enforcement issues, and be coordinating our efforts with the new magistrate. We're very hopeful that that works out. General Government Strong.
I got three motions to approve. First motion, a motion authorizing a Girl Scouts to use Memorial Hall on Saturday, February 18th, 2017 from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. for a cookie delivery and waive the fee.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded by Mrs. Wilford. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
Second motion, a motion to authorize the Boy Scouts to use Memorial Hall on Sunday, March 12th, 2017 from noon till 7 p.m. for the Blue and Gold Dinner and waive the fee.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded by Ms. Dixon. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chesno?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wilford?
Yes.
Mr. Nucci?
Yes.
Third one is a motion to authorize citywide garage door to do maintenance and repairs on all the borough doors at the cost not to exceed $2,000.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded by Ms. Dixon. Any questions on the motion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Chestnut?
Yes.
Ms. Dixon?
Yes.
Mr. Ellis?
Yes.
Mrs. Wolford?
Yes.
Yes. Anything else, Jerry?
Nope.
Any questions for General Government? Thank you, Jerry. Mayor's report, Mayor Spetz.
Thank you, Mr. President. We received a check from the magistrate's office for $1,241.61 on February 9th, and the police had a total of 216 calls last month.
Okay. Any questions for the mayor? Thank you, Mrs. Mayor. Secretary's report, Mrs. Stecker.
Thank you. In your mailboxes, I distributed a copy of the state statement of financial interest. You need to complete those and give me a copy by May 1st. And I am currently working on all the forms and reports and financials that are due by March 31st. That's all I have.
Okay. Any questions for the secretary? Thank you, Deputy Solicitor's report, Mr. Garvin.
No report this evening.
Any questions for the solicitor? Thank you, Barb. President's report. The COG meeting was fairly uneventful. There was some discussion about whether it was legal to do to our legal advertising electronically, and while I was working on that, we had discussed that about whether we could advertise some of these minor things in a, like on the Tribune electronic site, but we're not so sure about that. And then there's also they're trying to start a COG paving contract. It's possible that we could submit our quantities to COG, and it's not binding, and then that would be one more choice to pick from to do that. So, other than that, I do not think I have anything else. Any questions for me?
What's the timeline on that program?
As soon as possible.
Do we need a motion for
that? No, we would just submit it to them. Once we get the specs, we would just submit them to specs. It would just be one more person to submit the specs to. I think it may have been passed. But I'm not really sure. I think they wanted it as soon as possible. But I will know for sure this Thursday.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, any old business or new business? We have a public comment. Mr. Dan.
Two questions. Just clarification, Charlie. Mr. Butler, the streets program you mentioned,
yep.
The brick streets, that would be kind of going on at the same time if the logistics are worked out.
The same time as the paving?
The same time as the paving.
Yeah, this paving might only take maybe a week, right?
Okay.
A week. The brick program would go on the entire summer.
Right. But I mean, it's not we're either going to pave
one or the other.
Bricks, no. So
it's a separate program.
It would happen.
Okay.
All right, cool. Thank you. And for Ms. Dixon, this phone vote authorizing the police to attend, is that all the police?
It's
or
the
is that just the full-time?
Full-time.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, anything else? Okay, can we please have a motion to adjourn to executive session? Oh, I'm sorry, someone else said something?
Well, I know for the brick streets, are we just gonna fix like the sinkholes? Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah,
doing?
Well.
We're not gonna peel up all.
No.
Nope.
Just sinkholes,
yeah,
so
right.
Speak.
We don't have pumps, dips.
Okay.
Yeah.
My other question was, why are we communicating? And I just don't understand. Why are we communicating with Crafton on the issue that I brought up for issues? I mean, is it just better in numbers kind of thing?
No, he's asking about why are we trying to get our code enforced. Well, first of all, we try to get our code enforcement because we don't have time. We're trying to like share our code enforcement, but we're both dealing with the same magistrate. And that was one of our biggest issues we had was with our magistrate. Well, now we don't have a magistrate, he retired.
Right.
So now we got a monthly magistrate, comes in once a month. So now we want to go in numbers to the new magistrate and let him know that we want them to listen to us and try to help us make these people fix these issues instead of giving them 90 to 100 days to fix stuff.
Okay.
And the other issue.
I understand.
The other issue was when this very first started, he was working part-time here and part-time here, that we had discussed some months ago with them about possibly having a full-time person, that we could have extra time to be proactive rather than just a short amount of time to respond to complaints. So the original plan was to do that, and then it sort of got screwed up when Dave resigned. So that still may happen, and we may be sharing a code enforcement officer and not really duplicating efforts. And if that were the case, then we would probably want to align our ordinances so that he was clear and the magistrate was clear. You know, it's probably little things like height of grass and things like that, or timetables for shoveling. So that it was consistent
okay.
to the magistrate, it's consistent to the code enforcement officer. Now, just because Dave left does not mean we're not going to do that. Crafton right now has a temporary solution in place. They don't know if that's going to continue. We're sort of holding out hope that we can still do that. So in the meantime, we wanted to get the discussion going. What things can we share? What things make sense? What things don't make sense that we can work together on?
Okay.
I think with the new magistrate coming in, we were sort of hoping too that if two separate communities, we were both presenting these as big issues from this side and this side, he would take them more of importance to him as well. It has nothing to do with communities combining or anything like that. It was just we put more pressure, for lack of a better word, on the magistrate to show them that it's an issue here and an issue here. He might be more responsive.
All right. Okay.
Also, one more thing, That meeting was actually the first meeting in a series of meetings about a larger blight problem that was also came out of the comprehensive plan. Unfortunately, you can't see the plan yet because it hasn't been approved, although it's not going to change. It just has to be approved by council. It has to go through the planning commission first, and it has to be distributed to school districts and neighboring municipalities. But that was the real reason. So we started talking about code enforcement as a starting point. But ultimately, the idea is to start creating shared proactive processes, uniform construction codes, and things like that to get the larger problem under control.
We have a lot of issues, like we were sharing a code enforcement officer. We both have the same engineer, so we might be duplicating services that we don't have to duplicate.
Right.
So we're just looking at some of those different things on how we can cut costs and do a better job.
It makes a lot of sense when Joey said, Mr. Chisholm said, about the magistrate. I that didn't register with me
that's,
at first.
That was
I,
one of the main things we love to do, that we can say, this is what we want to do, this is our priorities, are you on board with us? And everybody's involved. And you know, that maybe means Carnegie too, and to say, you know, if everyone presents a united front that these are issues that we're very concerned about, then maybe it helps us with the enforcement end, which has been a problem in the past.
And we have no magistrate at this time.
We have a rotating magistrate that comes in and hears cases on a monthly basis, I believe.
And when do we get a new magistrate?
It's his election year this year.
That's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Mike Rosso, 209 Cup. Is that the only remedy to go to a magistrate? Do you have anything in place where people are notified first in person by a police officer, the maintenance supervisor, what have you, where they're approached in order to rectify a situation before it goes to a magistrate? Because I think a lot of these could be remedied rapidly. That's one question. The other one is for...
Well, that's generally been our policy. I mean, I can't think of any instances where someone right out of the gate got a citation.
Yeah, got a letter. For
a citation or a letter?
Both. Somebody, a 30-day letter.
A 30-day letter, generally. What did you get a citation for?
Wood. My father got chopped down.
And you didn't get a warning to police clean that up? No, that's much the exception.
Straight.
That's much the exception.
And
so, but generally that's, and if we do try to be more proactive, that's the kind of things that we're going to try to do.
Mm-hmm.
Get out in front of us.
Another question, Mr. Butler. When you do your assessment of the streets, how thorough is it and how do you do it? There's an undermined issue at Cotton Greenwood. Two slabs in, there's 2.5 feet of base gone. And I walk the street and see it. The receivers at both ends of the Cobb are collapsing. And I mean, I understand what you guys are up against financially, but it seems apparent to me that it isn't really that thorough. And sooner or later, that slab's gonna crack.
Is that a sewer issue? Or
I don't know. They did extensive
generally
work.
Generally, when you have that, things happen, those are sewer issues.
They did extensive work on that.
Under
right.
the sewer program.
Yeah, they did extensive work on that line that crosses Greenwood. Walking last week, I noticed that the patch was falling in. I got a stick and put it in. It was at least 2.5 feet down where there's no patch at all.
Is that where they did that sewer line?
Yeah.
Yes.
That was a big fiasco for about a year and a half?
Yeah, that's where they did the sewer line.
And then the receivers at both ends, when we have weather like we did where it snows and melts, they're collapsed before the actual receiver. So on the left side of Cobb, approaching Loy or however you pronounce that street,
Yes. It's
down below the receiver, so obviously the water can't get in. The one opposing, it's the exact opposite, it's above.
Right.
You know, so, and again, I'm not being critical.
No, that's interesting.
You know, something like that. I mean, I almost marked that street with marking paint because I know what's going to happen. A heavy truck is going to go and that slab is going to crack.
Well, how about this? Why don't you See Greg after the meeting, give him the exact details, and we can follow up on it and go take a look at it at the road reform. And I'm guessing from what you're telling me, the sewer issue, that would be different than the paving issue.
Right.
Handle those sewer issues.
Right, yeah.
Different fines in different ways. So why don't you follow up with Greg after the meeting, give him the exact locations, and we'll follow up on it.
And even that, to his point, you know, I'd be willing to do that too. But not,
that's great.
This happens to be my business too, but I'll walk the streets, volunteer.
Great.
To know things that you guys aren't going to catch every day.
Oh, that would be wonderful.
You know, and, right, and there are things like that that at eye level won't be a problem until it collapses, then it will be a big problem. And it happens to be on my street, but it's not unique. I mean, I don't want to see that happen anywhere to anywhere.
No, we don't need it. Yeah, it's a big problem. That's what we're saying. Are the areas where the tax barriers were coming in? I'm not sure. Get the information, Greg, after the meeting, and we'll definitely follow up on it. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. All right, please have a motion to adjourn to executive session and discuss the personnel matter. So moved by Mr. Chesney, second by Mr. Ellis. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Then the executive session.